there. If you've been able to watch our first and second videos in the Emergency Prepare series, you know that I'm Talia Ruscioni, the Education Director of the Bateman Horne Center of Excellence. I'm here with Linda Milne, who will now present on how networking saves lives. Linda?
Thanks, Talia. Hi, everyone. You may recall that I'm a longtime volunteer emergency specialist and ME/CFS patient. Talia and I have created a series of short videos about various emergency prepare topics. This is the third presentation in the series. I hope you will enjoy it. The topics flow one into the next, but each video can stand alone. I hope you were able to follow up with our earlier topics and identify the risks in your area and learn about the various governmental emergency plans where you live. We hope you will watch the full series, one short video at a time, during those moments your health permits, and come away with incremental steps that you can apply. Have you experienced an emergency or disaster where you currently live? If not, you've probably seen them presented in the media. In either case, did it prompt you to evaluate your own circumstances? Did you decide that you're prepared? Are you unprepared? Maybe underprepared? Do you have a family plan? Does someone in your household have a little disaster response know-how? Have your age or health limitations prevented you from taking steps to prepare and plan? At the time I started learning about emergency preparedness, I was bedbound and unable to meet my basic needs, let alone gather emergency items, put a plan together, or learn how to respond effectively to disaster. Even now, as a person who is prepared, I experience setbacks that make me incapable of responding appropriately. I want to share with you three preparation steps I took because of my age and health. I signed up for emergency help offered by a county registry. I spoke about this in a preceding video. I regard this as a backup plan. I place my full faith and trust in the next two steps. The first action I took was to reach out and make my needs known to the leadership of two churches and a synagogue nearby. Even now, I appreciate knowing that help is there for me because of my limitations. Religions are a strong emergency resource. Many emphasize helping non-members and non-participants in the event of a community-wide disaster. Our faith-based organizations are often the backbone of a neighborhood. Make yourself known to the leadership of religious organizations near you. Tell them you may not be able to take care of yourself and family in an emergency because of your health or age. Give them enough details that will make it real to them that you are vulnerable to risks and would need help. If they don't offer, ask them, would you be willing to check on my family in the event of an emergency? Emphasize, I don't expect you to rescue us, but would you look in on us if we need help? Would you direct the volunteer responders to our home? The next action I took was to sit down with three different neighbors with whom I have some rapport. Each lived just a few houses away on my street, not across the way, but close by so that they can get to me. Redundancy is essential. You know, people move, they travel, they lose interest, they age, and become less able to help. So three connections made sense for me. I told them approximately what I shared with the religious leaders. I'm doing my best to prepare, but my health, and in my case, my age, could limit my ability to respond to an emergency or community-wide disaster. I told them the health details that I felt they should know. I asked each of the three families directly, once you have taken care of your family's needs, would you check on me? If our area is told to evacuate, would you please report my circumstance and address to the volunteer leaders who will be rescuing people? Please notice, I did not make it their responsibility to rescue me or provide for me. I know they will do what they can, but their reporting of my circumstance to the trained volunteers is my surest way to get the help I might need. They all said, yes, absolutely. Maybe because they know I have made the effort to be prepared and will do what I can to help myself. Right now, if you are thinking, I don't know my neighbors, or I don't have rapport with three households, then that is your first step toward preparation. Reach out and make authentic connections with your neighbors. After you have built rapport, not before, ask for their help. This really should not wait. A neighborhood network is an essential part of your personal or family emergency plan. It can be a resource of needed first aid or even save your life. If there is never a need for your network, well, you've built or strengthened relationships. That's no small thing. In conclusion, please ask yourself, in a disaster, to what degree will I be dependent upon the kindness and intervention of religious volunteers and neighbors? So while it's advisable for you to sign up for emergency help if you have a registry, I strongly urge you to take the important actions I've outlined today and reach out to church and neighbors. Create your own neighborhood network and do it now. Honestly, it could save your life. The topics we have prepared going forward with our series will help you with an incremental approach to emergency preparation, personal and family planning, and learning about appropriate disaster responses. I've created a handout which lists our suggestions for emergency supplies. If you will email me and request a copy of this single page list, I will ensure you have it promptly because it will be helpful for you as we go into the next videos. Thanks so much for watching. And remember, your questions are always welcome. I will answer them. See you next time.